From the Game Sports Center on the campus of IPFW, welcome to IPFW basketball. It's the men's style now as the Mastodons of Coach Andy Piazza play host to the Raiders of Wisconsin Parkside. Hi, everybody. Mike Maz with you along with Jerry Garrado. And Jerry, two teams, though they have losing records, could cause some excitement tonight. At least we hope so.
Boy, if they can have any kind of game like they had last time out at Parkside where it was 92-91, and we'd really enjoy that, Michael. Put some points on the board, get up and down the floor. Of course, you'll go hoarse from calling out all those names, and I'll go nuts from all those points.
But that's what it's all about.
That's right. And, you know, this can be such a big ball game because the way in which the Dons have to close out the season, where next week they go to Southern Indiana and to SIU Edwardsville, you know, two of the more powerhouse teams, this is very, very crucial for them. You know, they've got that 10-game winning streak, and, you know, the kids are at the point where they're questioning themselves, and Andy's got to be questioning himself. It'd be nice to pick one up on your last night at home of the season and kind of close things out at home on a real good note.
Well, I hope they can do that tonight. Thursday night here at the Gates Sports Center, the Dons lost the ball game 75-69 to Lewis University. So IPFW coming into action tonight, 6 wins, 18 losses. Their counterparts from Wisconsin Parkside, slightly better. They are 6 up and 17 down. So, as you say, hopefully we can have a good ball game. The fans here in a pretty good mood. It's senior night, and they just saw the Lady Mastodons win their 11th in a row at home without a loss this year. They're 22nd overall in 25 starts as they defeated Wisconsin Parkside in the first game here by a score of 90-51. So let's hope the men can do well tonight as well.
Well, you know, the part that I think some people forget is that Casey Runyon is the only senior for IPFW. This is a young team, you know, a very young team. At the level of competition they're playing against, this same group of kids, there's going to be a world of difference just with a year's maturity and a year's more experience playing at the Division II level. You know, Ryan Bond did so many things early in the season and was off to such a super start, and he's literally been shut down the last 5 or 6 games just because people have gotten used to him. And I think that'll make a big difference to Ryan because for the first time in his career, he's going to have to make some adjustments. You know, I see him making a number of the moves that he was so successful with in high school, and they're just not working right now.
We'll be back with the starting lineups right after this message. Sports Information Director Matt DeLong out there on the court.
You know, and this goes on in, especially at this time of year, gymnasiums all over America, but especially here in basketball crazy Indiana. You know, you have so many kids on the high school level that they're playing in their final home game, their last night or tonight. You've got a kid like Casey, you know, his career is ending with his ball games next week. And he's got an awful lot of things that he's going to look back on, some with very great memories and some with very bittersweet. Obviously, he was hoping his senior career would not, you know, close out this way after the way they had played his freshman and sophomore year. But, you know, overall, such a tremendous experience playing collegiate athletics that I'm sure in the years to come, Casey will have some tremendous memories. And he's got to be bittersweet about tonight. You know, part of you is real excited about it. and part of you is just kind of very melancholy.
We'll be back in just a moment.
Shoot, they don't care who gets in the way.
I want to be respected. Just gets me respect, know what I'm saying?
I'm afraid to walk to school, okay?
Yeah, I might die. Everybody dies.
Kids shooting, kids getting shot. They're all victims of gun violence. The killing won't stop unless you help stop it. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT for free information. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more.
I don't want to die. Sciences is important, and we should all support that. But let's not forget that music and the other arts are also important. They help teach discipline, creativity, and problem-solving skills. The teaching of music is becoming diminished and even disappearing in some schools, and our nation is poorer for it. We cannot let it continue. So get involved, support music in our schools. I do.
You made it.
Hey, I couldn't have gotten through physics without you.
Yeah, well, you're on your own at college.
It's not fair.
It's all right. I'm going to get a job, you know. I'm going to start working. I'm going to save. And I'll be in college in another year or two.
So, what do you have planned, Mike?
I think we'll go home and make a sandwich. Okay, maybe.
Support the United Negro College Fund. A mind is a terrible thing to waste.
We're back at the Gates Sports Center. Mike Myers, Jerry Garrotta with you. We're about to get this one underway. Wisconsin Parkside, the visiting team, in their road black with white trim. They'll be heading from left to right on your screen. IPFW in the home white with blue trims. Cap controlled by IPFW, and we are underway.
And Kirby went a long way up in the air to get that one.
Kirby, baseline drive, shot up, no good. Rebound pulled down by Levi Bradley. We'll get the starters for you as we go along.
I talked to one of the Parkside coaches before the game, Mike, and not only is their team struggling, you know, they've lost three in a row, but he just didn't seem very fired up. It was more like, boy, I hope this sucker gets over with in a hurry so we can get on the bus and go home. And if their kids have that same kind of attitude, they could be in for a long night. As McCarty hits that three, he's their leading scorer at about 16 points a game and is leading the conference at close to 90% from the free throw line. He's 10th in the nation, Division II, at 88.5.
Kyle Kirby misses his second shot from the floor, grabbing the second rebound. Parkside on the run. McCarty for three, he's hit two in a row.
Boy, he's got a quick release. He just gets it, his legs are set, he's into his crouch, catches the ball in a shooting position, and he's ready to go as soon as the ball touches his hands.
Jackson takes it inside. He scores. He's fouled. And here go to the line shooting one.
Mike, we saw something unusual for IPFW those first two times down the floor with Kirby missing those two shots. You know, he's averaging like close to 69% from the floor and is leading the nation in Division II in field goal percentage. The only question right now, Matt DeLong was telling me, is if he's going to have enough attempts.
The personal foul was on Sonny Rogers, number 31, his first team first. And Jeff Jackson at the line converts the three-point play, so our score is 6-3, and we played a little over a minute. McCarty's number 32. Rogers 31. Number 5 is Brooks Banyai. 13 is Levi Bradley. 54 taking the shot was Brian By. He misses. IPFW with the rebound. Jackson, number 50, with the ball. Inside pass, Kirby, and third time's the charm. So Cal Kirby kick his first field goal.
Boy, Jackson did a nice job of getting the ball up the floor in a hurry and in the instant offense. I like that.
6-5 our score. We've played 2 minutes here. IPFW coming out there. Man-to-man. Jackson nearly a steal. Bradley has the ball knocked away, but a whistle and a foul is going to be called on Jeff Jackson.
Jackson doubled down in the post to help out, and when he did, his hands were just a bit too active. He had a near steal on the possession before out front against the man he's guarding. Just couldn't quite pull it off in the post.
Parkside to put the ball into play. Lob pass inside for Bradley. Left-hand shot is good. Levi Bradley with his first points, and it's 8-5. Set to the IPFW lineup for you right now. Jackson and Whirling are at the guards. Runyon and Kirby are the forwards, and Dane Adams has replaced Ryan Vaughn at center. Inside pass, Kirby. He's good. He's fouled.
Nice look inside by Casey Runyon. He gave a little fake at the high post to Kirby, and when Kirby didn't have it, slid down the lane. Casey did a good job being patient, dumping it inside to him.
Fouls on Byron by his first team, second. Jerry, four times down the court, four times they've gotten the ball inside to Kirby.
Well, evidently something must have happened when they played last time that they knew their inside game could be there, because even Jackson, who scored, took the ball hard to the basket. Now, that tells me, with the way they've attacked the first four or five times down the floor, that there's some problems on the interior defense of Parkside.
Free throw was missed. Shot missed by Bradley. Gets the rebound, and we got a whistle underneath.
Get it.
Got to call Cal Kirby for the foul. His first, team second.
Parkside doing a very good job setting interior picks, and IPFW not able to either switch very well. Ah, we got a 5 second call. Nice defensive series there. Or not being able to fight through those picks, and it's Parkside's been able to get the ball inside fairly easily. Boy, this is a program that was a powerhouse 6 or 7 years ago that's really fallen on some hard times. Reese Johnson, who's now at Northeastern, is a good friend of mine, was at Parkside, had just built up a powerhouse. In fact, they had a couple kids going to the NBA.
Good hustle by Kirby to get the ball from going out of bounds. 13 in the shot clock. Runyon, shot blocked. Gets it inside. Kirby for the fifth time. It's his third field goal. IPFW with a 9-8 lead in the night.
Parkside's going to have to make some adjustments, either double down on him or switch who's playing on him defensively. And if they double down, and that's going to outside really open up Whirling and Glidden on the outside for some threes.
Three-point shot is good by Sonny Rogers. It's three long balls so far. Now we got a whistle and a pushing foul.
Sonny, a junior out of Peoria, played for a great Peoria East team. It was like their third leading scorer and averaged about 17 points a game 3 years ago. They went to the, I don't remember if it was the final game or won the state in Illinois that year, but they really had an outstanding team.
Foul was called on Byron by his second team, third substitutions. He goes out, replaced by Mark Houdeker, number 40, a 6'7", 193-pound senior. And replacing Manya in the guard spot, number 3, Calvin Lucas. Shot by Runyon off the iron, no good. Tap fought for, controlled by Sonny Rogers. Here comes Wisconsin Parkside on the run. Coast to coast, shot no good. Adams with the rebound. It's going to be a racehorse game, Jerry.
Both teams really looking to push it up a lot. Both teams taking the ball to the basket hard.
Jackson misses, but Kirby on the spot. Now Kirby's already got 8 points on 4 of 6 shooting from the floor.
Mike, we may be on track for that 90-something to 90-something ball game. Good luck to your boys.
Well, we'll find out. It's only game number 3 today.
Up, team!
Parkside, long jump shot, 3-point attempt. No good. Adams controls the rebound. Thought there might be a foul.
Yeah, Dane was real lucky he didn't get it over the back call.
Jackson stops, pops short, ball goes out of bounds. It'll be Parkside basketball.
And Andy Piazza has that look on his face like, you know, just total disbelief. What exactly was that?
You get a good look at Marty Gillespie there, a brief look as it was. head coach of the Rangers. 11-11 our score, 15 minutes to go here in the first half. Glad you're with us here on Channel 6. Another three-point attempt on the way by Rogers. No good. Jackson comes down with the ball. Co-captain brings it up. Now they can do a half-court offense. That's something unusual.
Well, if they make more than two passes, they're in a delay game tonight.
Jackson says, let's regroup, guys. 12 on the shot clock. Takes it inside, kicks it out. Runyon for three. Yes! What?
That's something rare, because Kyle doesn't take very many of those.
The next on that one, and it's 14-11 on DFW on top.
See, the bad part about that is that your coach is, kid you've been telling, now that's outside your range all year. Now he's going to come in the locker room and say, hey, coach, you know, I hit those puppies.
Got 15 on the shot clock. Parkside trying to work the ball around. Bradley takes it inside, reverse layup, no good. Rebound, Kirby. That's on the run. Oh, passes in it for Whirling, picked off by Lucas.
Hey, Mike, you know, one thing, if the pace continues at this point, it'll be interesting to see how the guys' conditioning adjust, because a lot of these guys are not used to playing this kind of racehorse game. I know this is not the Parkside coaching staff's liking. I said that assistant coach had told me that, you know, they want to play in the 60s. Well, what, in the first half? It's like Loyola Marymount right now.
McCarty missed a three-point shot. IPFW with the rebound. They reverse the ball now and start over. Jackson blocked by Rogers. Inside pass Adams underneath. Gets it back out. Three-pointer by Whirling. Yes! It's Whirling. It's his first play tonight. Second try for the Dons. They're up 17-11.
We're going to have a timeout by Wisconsin Parkside.
College Cable Access Program Guide provides information about our programming, including IPFW Sports Telecast. To receive your free Channel 6 Program Guide, send your name, address, and zip code to Channel 6 at IPFW, 2101 Coliseum Boulevard East, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46805, or call us at 481-6000. Jerry, we've played almost 7.5 minutes, and an unusual sight, not knocking the Dons, but unusual to see them on top this early, 17-11.
Well, not only that they're on top by 6 points, but how many points have been scored? You know, the pace that they've played at, we haven't seen in a while. And realistically, although it's kind of tough to coach those kind of games because you don't have very much control over them, it may be to IPFW's liking. You know, they're not real big and bulky inside. You don't have the 6'10", 6'11 type bangers inside in order to dominate a half-court game. And you've got the guys that can shoot the three. You know, this is one of the best three-point shooting teams in the whole country as far as Division II goes. And, you know, they shoot the ball over 42% from three-point range. Let's get up and down the floor. You know, if we can get it inside and shove it inside and get some easy baskets before the defense gets set, and evidently Parkside feels the same way. You know, that Parkside team I talked about, I believe they won a national championship. They went 6'11", 6'11", 7 feet across the front line. Now, they didn't do a whole lot of racehorse basketball.
Sounds like the old Jacksonville team with Ernest Gilmore.
Yeah.
Remember Meadows. Parkside with the basketball. Got some substitutions. We'll get into you momentarily by DFW. Whoa, bumping going on between Bond and Outaker. That's who they're going to call a foul on.
Yeah, is it going to be on the guy that threw the seventh or the eighth elbow? Because they certainly didn't catch it on the first six.
They're going to call Mark Outaker with the foul, his first, team fourth. Substitutions for IPFW. Number 10, Ryan Blitt. Ryan Bond back in pit number 44. Number 12, Derek Miller. And number 33, Aaron Ishman. Ball knocked out of bounds. It remains IPFW possession.
And say, my goodness sake, you know, well, how can Kirby come out of the ballgame? He's got, what, 6-8 points already?
Eight.
Kyle really looked like he was sucking air those last couple times up and down the floor. So so Andy may just get him a blow for a couple minutes, get him right back in the game before he gets cooled off too much.
Should be remembered that Kyle has been sick with the flu the last couple of weeks as well. Glidden inside pass, Runyon kicks it back out. 8 in the shot clock. Runyon going to force one up from long distance off the rim. No good. Fight for the rebound. And who's got it? Glidden does. No foul. Ball gets loose. Helter Skelter. Parkside comes up with it. Lucas 1-on-3. Makes better of it.
I guess the refs aren't being paid by the whistle. We saw Bond pass up a shot at the elbow. That's something he's got to add to his repertoire, because at 6'7", and although he's strong, somewhat lean, he can't just count on banging inside for the rest of his career.
Bradley in the turnaround jumper. That's 4 points now for Levi Bradley.
He's the leading scorer on the Parkside team at 18 points a game.
Glidden takes it coast to coast, plays it up and in.
Nice move by Glidden, but you know, the key to that whole thing was Ishman set a tremendous pick on the baseline and kind of opened it up for him.
Ryan Glidden averaging 13 and a half points a game, gets his first bucket of the night. Ball knocked out of bounds. That's substitution. Number 24, Thad Jacobs, 6'175" junior, checks in. He replaces Ryan McCarty.
Jacobs, the fifth leading scorer on the team at 8 points a game. Kind of a three-point specialist.
Rangers on the attack. Ten on the shot clock. Shake and bake. Baseline drive, shot up and in. And how? I believe that was Craig Evans. Got that ball, I'm not sure. Now ball turned over. 3-on-1 opportunity. Shot no good by Hautaker, but Marker go to the line shooting 2.
It didn't look like Hautaker ever really got a handle on the ball. You know, he caught it and gave it one of those NBA scoops to the basket where you take 2 or 3 steps looking to jam it. And as he went up, he kind of played volleyball with himself in the air. Didn't quite get his hands on the ball.
Fouls charged to Ryan Glidden, his first. Team third into the lineup by BMW, number 20, R.J. Falcone, 6-foot, 170-pound freshman.
You know, any of you that are tuning in that say, well, this is only the first half, and something seems just a little bit off right here. Aren't teams normally in front of their own bench offensively in the second half? Well, it's the visiting team's prerogative on which basket they want in the first half, and we had a little bit of upsmanship on the part of Parkside as they warmed up on the IPFW end in pregame.
Ball knocked away. Shot up. No good. Tap up and in by Hautaker as he rebounded Evans' missed shot. Makes the score 19-18. IPFW on top. Right at the 10-minute mark here in the first half. Bond taking it up. Getting fouled on the way up. So.
Well, Ryan's got to be real active offensively right now, because with this particular lineup, Falcone and Miller are not great scorers. Ishman's more or less of a banger, where, you know, he looks to get his points up off of offensive boards or some tip-ins, maybe a free throw here and there. So offensively, you basically got Bond and Glidden in order to score points.
Glidden hits the tray. That was not a shooting foul, but IBFW will take the tray anytime. Glidden now has 5 points, and it's a 22-18 down advantage.
Give you one of the most illogical stats in basketball. Glidden averages almost 41% field goal shooting, but he shoots close to 44 from three-point range.
Long jumper by Jacobs is good. Matt has a bucket now. And the racehorse game continues. 22-20. Glidden taking it to the hall. He misses. Ball loose. Picked off by Hautaker. And the Rangers are on the run. Lead pass. Bradley jams it home. Levi Bradley with a half a dozen, and we're tied at 22. 9 minutes to go. Falcone on the other end. He knocks it out of the field. So the horse race continues. R.J. Falcone on the score sheet with a noose.
Yes, denial. Yes, denial. Purdue going to high post reverse.
Inside best ball knocked away by Falcone. Good defense by R.J. Bradley's scoring.
And R.J. may have got away with one, because I thought he tapped that ball away from him. Parkside player, and yet IPFW got it back, so we'll take it.
Kyle Kirby back in the lineup, replacing Aaron Ishman for IPFW. 8:35 to go, 24-22, IPFW in front.
Kirby draws a crowd now when he gets the basketball.
Nice pass inside to Miller from Clinton. Eric Miller out
nice
there.
Backdoor move. Miller takes a step out, fakes as if he's coming on the wing, and gets the ball and cuts backdoor and gets a good return pass.
Going hard down is Craig Evans. Went in for the shot, got hammered. Fouls on Falcone, his first team fourth. Got McCarty coming back in the lineup for Parkside, along with Sonny Rogers.
You know, right now, both coaches have to be really concerned about their baseline and interior defense. You know, other than McCarty's had two shots from the outside, and Glidden had one from the left wing that was a three-pointer. Everything else has been baseline inside. Neither team has shown much of a propensity for stopping the other team.
First free throw by Evans is good. He now has 3 points. Making four as he's 2 for 2 from the stripe. And he brings the Rangers to within two at 26-24 with 8:10 to go here in the first half. Kirby taking it down and getting it.
And kind of an unusual spin on it. Kind of had a backspin that took it over the top of the rim.
Ryan Kirby missed his first two shots from the floor, and he's had 5 in a row since then. He's in double digits with 10 points. Nice play by Ryan Good. He picks off the pass. Miller drives in the lane and he's fouled.
And one of the things I'm noticing, Mike, is that whenever there's any kind of penetration, the Parkside kids aren't moving their feet in order to shut off that penetration. They just kind of form a little triangle and reach or put their hands straight up in the air. IPFW obviously has noticed that, is taking full advantage of it.
Now we've got a whistle and a timeout, I believe, called. Breaking the action. We'll be back after you hear these important messages.
Again, we'll be ready to get them.
They just shoot. They don't care who gets in the way.
I want to be respected. Just get me respect, know what I'm saying?
I'm afraid to walk to school. Okay?
Yeah, I might die. Everybody dies.
Kids shooting. Kids getting shot. They're all victims of gun violence. The killing won't stop unless you help stop it. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT for free information. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more.
I don't want to die.
Welcome back to the Gates Sports Center, everybody. Mike Moss, Jerry Garano with you. And 28-24, Don's lead, 7:43 to go. And even though Kirby's got 10 points, he's got some support, Jerry.
It's sort of like whoever's got the ball seems to have the hot hand.
Got Jackson with 3, Runyon with 3, Whirling with 3, Miller and Falcone 2 apiece, Glidden with the deuce and a tray for 5. So.
And obviously both teams are having success running up and down the floor. So you kind of say, okay, that's going to knock each other off. Now, which one's going to execute their half-court offense better on the rare times that they want to get into it? And the other thing is who's going to play defense better?
Dines with the basketball. Kirby and Mark made nice feed to Miller, who kicks it off to Vaughn. And Vaughn thought better of taking that shot. So give and go. Now we got a whistle.
So you can see the frustration on Ryan. Those have been moves when he gets it on the low post. He likes to dip that right shoulder and scoop underneath. He's very good at leaning at about a 45-degree angle on a duck under move. The other thing he does is does a drop step, comes into the middle, and gives a little running jump hook. And people have just played him. You know, they know what's coming, and they've played against him for it.
Foul was by Levi Bradley, his second 17th foul, so Bond at the line. And he makes good on his first free throw. That's his first point of the night. Team leader in scoring, averaging 15.2 points per contest.
We've seen his minutes go down as his frustration has gone up. You know, Ryan's just been unable to execute some things, and I think that's frustrated him a great deal. He's picked up some silly fouls and tried to overextend himself defensively. Nice hustle play by
good
Miller.
Good defensive play by Derek Miller, knocked the ball out of Sonny Rogers' hands. Rogers at the deck, but no foul called, so set the shot clock. My new place. It's at 30. Yes, ma'am. IPFW's taking that man-to-man defense. Here in your 7 minute mark, IPFW on top, 30 to 24. Ball knocked away. But you got it. Loose. Witt picks it off. Good hustle by the Dons. Witt, spin move, shot up, no good. Kirby with the rebound. He goes up, he's fouled. Now Kirby goes to the line shooting two.
That was really a pretty move by Glidden. As he did a little hesitation, brought the ball on the right side, stood straight up, gave the defense the impression he was going to hold up, and then put it on the floor, crossed over to his left hand, really did a nice job penetrating.
Now Kirby makes the free throw. The foul, by the way, was on Houdeker, his second. Now Kirby, 11 points, make it 12 so far tonight. Good start, 6-6 sophomore. Dons, I think, with their biggest lead, 32-24. Trap employed by IPFW. Ball knocked away. Glidden going to take it all the way, lay it up and in. Nice trapping defense there. Glidden, the beneficiary of the Dukes. He now has seven. Houdeker gets the ball up and in.
The problem Parkside had is he picked the ball up right across the 10-second line, and therefore he allowed it. 10-second line to serve as an additional defender, so he was actually triple-teamed.
Give it go, Kirby double-team, keeps it back out. Don's moving the ball around. Jackson brings it back out, 10 on the shot clock. Jackson shakes, banks. Forces one up, no good. Rebound controlled by Bradley.
I think he defied the laws of physics just in order to be able to get that off. The Dons have done a real nice job on McCarty. You know, McCarty got two quick threes early, and they've really shut him off even as far as getting good touches since then.
Houdeker scores, but disallowed the basket. He pushed off, and somebody got wide open. That's his third, team ninth. Substitutions, number 21, Rico Martin, 6'4", 180 pound freshman from Fort Wayne for IPFW. We've got Brian By coming back in the lineup for Parkside, as is number 4, Steve Lipke, 6'2", 165 pound sophomore. Meanwhile, at the line, Ryan Bond just made two a moment ago, tries his luck again. Short, Bradley with the ball, ball knocked away, but picked up by Lipke. So here come the Rangers on the attack, trailing 34-26 with 5:24 to go here in the first half.
Good
battle underneath.
Have a closely guarded call there, I think.
I think so. 5 second call. I was noticing the battle underneath between McCarty and Cal Kirby in the paint. Dons get it.
There's going to be some sharpening of elbows going on at halftime.
Bond loses the ball out of bounds. Turnover. Ball goes over to Parkside. 5:07 left to go in the half. Glad you tuned us in tonight here on Channel 6. Now we got a technical foul called on somebody. Piazza, head coach of the Dons, just got hit with a technical foul. Jerry, you want to expound?
Well, I really and truly do believe that. You know, sometimes a coach gets a tech for effect. Sometimes you get a tech because you just kind of, you're so curious you don't care one way or the other. And then the third reason is once in a great while you have a referee with rabbit ears. That, you know, he's just listening. And most refs will tell you, chirp all you want, don't use any magic words, and don't try and show me up. And he didn't do any of those things. I mean, the things that he was chirping about were inconsequential, and the ref was trailing the play. First of all, he was too far behind the play before he should have been in position. And then he really had rabbit ears on that. He was almost listening, looking for an excuse. I don't know, maybe you never talked about earlier, Mike, about experience. You know, last year, Rico Martin was a pusher, you know, one of the bigger, stronger kids in the whole city of Fort Wayne and an outstanding player. And this year on the collegiate level, he's a pushy.
Kirby in the blocks. He's going to go offensive foul.
Yeah, they're going to call him for a hook, and he did.
Second foul on Cal Kirby. Fifth team foul. So, with 4:09 to go, as you see Cal Kirby going back, shaking his head.
We've seen this happen before. When the Dons get in a half court and one guy gets the ball, especially down low, four other guys stand around and watch a whole lot. And it makes it real difficult for that one player, if he's double-teamed or can't maneuver, to get the ball off to somebody else.
Parkside moving the ball on the perimeter. 12 on the shot clock.
Bond is really working hard against a much bigger, stronger player inside.
Jackson nearly gets the steal. Ball goes out of bounds. Substitution. 21, Craig Evans back in. Parkside. 54, Paul Ryder. First appearance of the night, along with Whirling. Casey Rutten, brought to BMW. Paul Ryder, a 6'8", 235-pound freshman out of Bay City, Michigan. Put in there for a size effect more than anything else.
Well, Parkside lists by at number 54 at 6'8", 190. There's no way. He's about 6'9", probably 220 or 230.
Lidke in the turnaround jumper. He gets his first bucket of the night. Now the score is 34-32 with 3.5 minutes to go. It's 34-26 just a few moments ago. Ryder misses the baseline shot. Rogers with the rebound. Going to go coast to coast. Stop. Pop and in. No, in and out. Rebound. Ryan Bond. So...
the Dons have got to make the Rangers pick the basketball up 30 feet away from the basket and start an offense. They can't let him start the offense 4 feet away from the basket.
Education reform movement, which emphasizes math and sciences, is important, and we should all support that. But let's not forget that music and the other arts are also important. They help teach discipline, creativity, and problem-solving skills. The teaching of music is becoming diminished and even disappearing in some schools, and our nation is poorer for it. We cannot let it continue. So get involved. Support music in our schools. I do.
Sports Center, 2:02 left, first half. Ryan Bond at the line, making the first of a one and bonus situation. Gives Ryan 3 points on the night.
Mike, to elaborate on what I was saying before, you know, sometimes, especially guys' games, have a tendency to get caught up with so much of that macho type stuff that the guys get caught up in figuring out who they're going to bang next rather than concentrate on playing the game, and it really takes them out of their concentration on what they've been successful at.
Cardi taking it inside. He puts it up, puts it in, and he's fouled.
Awkward, but effective. You know, you don't find that as much in women's basketball, and that's one of the finer points of women's basketball. Although it gets physical, the women are kind of able to brush that off and go ahead and play their game. You know, the guys get caught up in that. Well, I, you know, can't afford to be a weenie. I can't back down at all.
Fouls on Ryan Worley, or Jason Worley, rather, hits first. Free throw good, so McCurdy completes the three-point play. He's now got 11 points.
You know, he's the type of kid that I'll bet as a little boy, every time his mama dressed him up, he came home as a pigman. He's got scrapes on both legs, kind of a little bit of a shaggy couple days growth of beard, scabs all over his legs and elbows from diving on the floor.
Runyon misses the short shot, rebound controlled by Bai. Parkside with a chance to take the lead. Defense by Runyon on Lucas. We're down to 15 in the shot clock. 1:15 in the first half, game clock. Lucas shakes, fakes, loses the ball. Picked up. Rogers from long distance, no good. Ball knocked out of bounds, Graham, over the back foul. Called against Craig Evans.
You know, poor Casey, there's nothing he can do with that because there is no way possible he's going to keep up with the quickness of Lucas. It's not going to happen. Lucas, their top assist man, averaging about 9 points a game, but he's a good two steps quicker than Casey. You got Lucas shaking, banking 25 feet, and Runyon's like, get in here where I can beat on you. Don't be so far away.
Fouls on Evans, as we said, his second. Ryan Bond will shoot two as Parkside is over the 10-foul limit. This is the first. Ryan, 4 of 6 so far tonight at the line. 6'7 junior, played his high school ball for Terry Flynn at Southside High School. Gave you fits a few times.
Oh, tremendous high school player. Just tremendous. Probably the most dominating player in the Fort Wayne area as a senior.
Second free throw good. Now we got McCurdy coming back in the lineup, replacing Sonny Rogers for Wisconsin Parkside. IPFW going to play a little full court denial. They break it eventually. Under a minute now, 53 seconds of counting. In the first half, Lindke going to try one from long distance. It hits. Lindke has a tray to go along with the deuce. Parkside has taken the lead, 38-37. Down to 30 seconds left in the half. Bond moving in, baseline jumper, yes! Ryan Bond gets the break. IPFW to lead back, 39-38, 12 seconds to go. Parkside, they had the last shot. Lucas, three-pointer off the iron, no good. Rebound controlled by Evans. Lindke for three, no, rebound with the rebound, the push is out. Then the first half to play, so teams did a little running up and down the floor, threw a few hooks, jabs along the way, and headed to the locker room. Our score at halftime finds IPFW on top of Wisconsin Parkside, 39-38. So, teams go into the locker room, get a rest, get some instruction, and we'll see what happens. So,
well, we saw Wisconsin Parkside run off the floor. They had a little bit of spring to their step. We saw IPFW kind of semi-jog, semi-walk off. Big difference. Early in the game, during those first couple timeouts, we saw Parkside walk to their huddle. We saw IPFW run to their huddle. And that's exactly what has happened, is that the Dons have gotten away from their running game. You know, they were so effective early in the ballgame by really getting up and down the floor and being able to take the ball inside, take the ball to the basket hard before the defense could get set up. And that's vanished. They've now gotten into a half-court game where it's dump the ball inside and then stand around and watch for Kirby or Bond or whoever's going to do something with the basketball.
Well, it'll be interesting to see what adjustments are made here in the second half. So, I halftime, 39-38. That's on top. We'll take a break. Take a break, rather. You watch this. We'll be back shortly.
This vehicle can take you to places no other vehicle can. To strange worlds and even stranger life forms. It can take you inside a human heartbeat to the innermost mysteries of life itself. It can take you to the silicon landscapes of tomorrow's supercomputers. It can even take you to a world where information travels on highways of light. This incredible vehicle can take you as far as your ability and imagination will allow. But only if you don't bail out. So stay in school. This message was brought to you by the United States Air Force, because we know how far a good education can take you.
Check it out!
The campus has it all.
Learn it, work it, apply it, just do it. It's a cool place. Call now. Go to work, go to school, go ahead.
They want to get me. To get them.
They just shoot. They don't care who gets in the way.
I want to be respected. This gets me respect, know what I'm saying?
I'm afraid to walk to school. Okay?
Yeah, I might die. Everybody dies.
Kids shooting. Kids getting shot. They're all victims of gun violence. The killing won't stop unless you help stop it. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT for free information. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more.
I don't want to die.
Throughout America, there are a lot of hungry mouths to feed. Please remember, 12 million of them are children. You can help feed a child in your community today. Just call Second Harvest, America's food bank network.
Living legacy to Dr. King and his dream.
He had a dream?
Oh, yes. He had a dream for freedom, justice, and equality for all people, everywhere.
What's this?
This is the Nobel Peace Prize awarded to Dr. King for his nonviolent work.
What's that?
That's the proclamation declaring Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday a national holiday, a holiday for peace.
Was Dr. King a good man?
Was he a smart man?
Was he a kind man?
Yes, he was all of these things.
How come you know so much about him?
Yeah!
Because he was also my father.
Come on, let freedom ring, and that's right, for Martin.
eyes. Because.
Hey, you lost your toothbrush. What do you want for Christmas?
I don't know.
If you don't stop someone from driving drunk, who will?
My two friends.
Do whatever it takes.
Team Spirit is alive and well at IPFW. That's because IPFW has established itself as an athletic power, not only regionally, but nationally. With 11 major sports, IPFW offers talented student athletes great opportunities. Success and support of IPFW athletics comes solely from the fans, students, faculty, alumni, and the prestigious Royal Dons Club. The Royal Dons Athletic Club has over 500 members who financially support IPFW athletics, enabling the university to provide scholarships to deserving athletes. Members will receive one or all of the following: season passes to all sporting events, special seating, hospitality room, plus Royal Dons apparel and gifts. Be a part of the winning tradition. Join the Royal Dons Club. We need your support. Call IPFW Athletics. Get into the team spirit.
Check it out. Just do it. It's a cool place. Call now. Go to work, go to school, go ahead.
They want to get me. We'll be ready to get them.
They just shoot. They don't care who gets in the way.
I want to be respected. Gets me respect, know what I'm saying?
I'm afraid to walk to school, okay?
Yeah, I might die. Everybody dies.
Kids shooting, kids getting shot. They're all victims of gun violence. The killing won't stop unless you help stop it. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT for free information. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more.
I don't want to die.
Sally wants to be a surgeon someday. Maybe she'll operate on you. Now, would you like a free booklet of simple ways you can help improve her education? Call 1-800-96-PROMISE.
Why would anybody give someone they don't know a gift? Because the need is desperate. Please give blood. There's a life to be saved right now.
Hello, I'm Kenny G. New national standards for music and the other arts in our public schools can help ensure your child receives a complete education. To find out more, call this toll-free number.
Welcome back to the Game Sports Center, everybody. Mike Myers, Jerry Garrotta with you. Second half about to begin. And Jerry, IPFW up 39-38 at the break. What can we expect here in the second half?
Well, they're going to have to push the ball up the floor again. That's where they had a great deal of success. They're going to have to play better interior defense and do a better job on the baseline defensively. Those were the two areas that Parkside really hurt them. Statistically, both teams about even, over 50% from the floor, about even rebounds, about even turnover-wise. So it reflects the score of the game.
Starting lineups back in for both clubs. We're underway. Parkside with the ball. Nice give and go, and making the basket is Craig Evans. He now has 6 points, and Parkside takes the lead 40-39. Jackson, Whirling, Bond, Kirby, and Runyon on the floor for IPFW.
It'll be real interesting to see which team comes out with the most amount of enthusiasm in these first 3 or 4 minutes, whether the momentum that Parkside had at the tail end of the half will take over, or the great start that IPFW had will be able to carry over for them.
Runyon for three off the iron, no good. Rebound controlled by Evans. Got Lidke, McCarty, Evans, Rogers, and Bradley on the floor for Parkside. Lob pass inside, whistle. Pushing foul on Parkside. Offensive player control foul.
Well, IPFW are playing in front, or having the guy. Having means you got half your body in front, half behind. And you see the Parkside kids floating the basket pretty wide open. The reason for that is they're getting a nice push off.
Now we got a whistle. Ball came in on the floor from the stands. Momentary delay. That file incidentally was charged to Levi Bradley. He is the third. He and Howdicker have 3 files apiece. For Parkside, nobody in any foul trouble for IPFW. Kirby has 2. Whirling kicks it off. Bot spin move, baseline shot up. No, tap. 1-4. Runyon has it underneath the body. Roddy was hammered, but he got the bucket.
It's a nice look by Casey. Went up in the air and had about a 12-footer, but spotted Bond right underneath the basket. Ryan very alert in being awake to be able to catch the basketball. A lot of times you see those kind of passes go off somebody's head out of bounds.
IPFW back in front, 41-40. Played nearly 2 minutes of the second half. Cross kicked by Whirling. They're going to reset the shot clock at 35. It was interesting, Gerald, you mentioned both teams shot over 50%, IPFW 54%, Parkside 52% from the floor in the first half.
I don't know if that means great shooting or terrible defense, one of the two might. But anyway, it was made for a very entertaining half of basketball.
Bradley shakes, fakes, cut off by Kirby, good defense there. Kicks it back out. Inside, going to have a foul called on Jason Whirling.
See, and both teams are struggling right now, not only in the game, but it's kind of reflective of how their seasons have gone. The Dons have lost 10 in a row. Parkside's lost like 6 of their last 8. And both of them have a sniff that they have a chance to be able to pick one off tonight. So enthusiasm and confidence and mental attitude and approach is going to have a great deal to do with the outcome of tonight's game.
Now we got an illegal screen set up by Steve Lipke.
Remember we talked about in the first half, Mike, that referees were really going to have to take control of the game because it could really get away from them and we could have a fight. We've seen 3 or 4 real touchy calls in the first 2.5 minutes. Now, it slowed down momentum, but the referees are kind of sending a message that you're not going to get away with the same stuff you did in the first half.
Kirby on a bond screen. In, out, and in again.
He kind of repainted the rim. Touched every bit of it.
Now, Kirby has 14 points. He missed his first 2 shots in the ball game. Since then, he has made 6 in a row. 3-point lead. Ball knocked out of bounds since they last touched by Parkside.
Don's doing a much better job interior-wise as far as they're making switches rather than trying to fight through screens. It has caused major problems for Parkside as the same openings aren't there that were there in the first half.
Parkside playing man-to-man defense here. Runyon for 3, yes, Casey Runyon.
Did a much better job getting his feet set, having them underneath him and pointed at the basket when he took off on that 3 than he did the time before.
Second tray of the night for Casey Runyon.
And the Dons are probably about 1 turnover away from causing Parkside to have to take a timeout.
Pass intended for Bradley, knocked out of bounds. Oh, got him. Oh, I thought the ball was knocked out of bounds by Bond.
Well, it went off Bond's hands. And then I think it caught Levi Bradley just before it went out of bounds. Now, bucket here, they can get that timeout. That's always kind of a psychological game you play, too. Force the other team to take the first timeout of the half.
Whirling on a pick by Kirby, Runyon rather, on screen, I should say. It's not over again. Illegal screen by KC Runyon. It's his first foul tonight, team 2nd. We'll get it right here eventually.
Caught Casey on a moving screen. Boy, they have gone from a slugfest to ticky-tack.
Kind of a scary thought in a way.
Yes, it is.
You're always taught to be consistent as officials. Changing your mode of operation halfway through the game.
Well, it's difficult for the kids to get used to.
Carney lob pass inside to Bradley. Bradley with a drive on Kirby.
And that was a double dribble, folks.
Ball knocked away, pick up by Bradley. 3 on the shot clock. Bradley finally fires and hits right at the buzzer. So Bradley now in double figures with 10 points. Cuts the lead to 4, 46-42. Loose ball out of bounds. They say last touch by IPFW, so.
Boy, you know, that's a tremendous swing right there, Mike, because You had whirling coming off the screen on the last series and getting to three, but they called it off because of a moving screen. Then you got Bradley double dribble at the other end that wasn't called, and he hits a shot right at the buzzer for the shot clock. That's a 5-point swing.
Ryan Glick checks in the lineup, replacing Jackson for IPFW. Inside pass, Evans is hammered, no foul. Now he gets fouled by Kirby. Actually got fouled before that.
You just say third time's a charm. That was the third time he got fouled on the same play.
So Kirby picks up his third foul, and that might have a bearing as we move along here in the second half. Number 40, Mark Houdeker checks into the lineup for Parkside, replacing Bradley. Bradley checks out with 10 points, 3 fouls. Houdeker comes in with 5 points and 3 fouls. And here's somebody we haven't seen in a long time come in the lineup. Evans misses his first free throw. Number 40, J.B. Showalter, a 6'9", 200-pound, 10-pound sophomore, makes his first appearance in quite a while for IPFW. He replaces Runyon, I'm sorry.
Came in for Kirby.
Second free throw by Evans is good.
Evans did a nice job playing very, very alertly and getting a good head fake, getting two IPFW players to commit before he left the floor and drew the foul.
The lead for IPFW is 3, 46-43 as we hit the 15-minute mark here in the second half. Inside pass to Runyon. Shot up off the rim, good tap up and in. Nice follow-up.
That was just a sheer hustle play. Parkside didn't block out. Casey follows his shot with a nice little tap back.
Spin move by Evans, shot up and in. Greg Evans now, 5 points in the second half, 9 points in the game. Lead back down, and ball taken away by McCarty, and he's fouled. And I'll be honest, I'm surprised they didn't almost call an intentional foul.
And that was a good foul. That was a good foul by Casey. You know, he stops McCarty from an obvious, easy basket opportunity. We talked about McCarty having 4 burns all over. I think he just added a couple more to his collection. Really a hard-working kid.
Second foul on Casey Runyon, 14th foul here in the second half. Rogers forces one up off the iron, no good. Two players, Evans and McCarty, fight for the rebound, and IPFW comes down with it. Clint caught the bucket. Clint takes the bucket. They call offensive foul afterwards. Yeah, they do. So Glenn gets the bucket, is called for the foul.
That could have gone either way. They could have got him for a lean-in because he had position established, kind of hipped his way underneath Glidden. But Glidden definitely made contact. And I think he kind of led with that right knee up in the air.
Marty Gillespie was arguing that the basket shouldn't count. It did. It's now a 50-45 lead for IPFW, under 14 minutes to go. Evans' turnaround jumper is good. Craig Evans is heating up. He's got 7 points out of the 9 he scored here in the second half.
Nice little baseline turnaround. Very effective use of his athletic tools.
Ball knocked away, picked up by Lidke. He's going to get fouled by Glitch. He goes down hard. Andy Piazza not very happy with that fight. Primarily, I think, the pass more than anything else. So Ryan Glidden picks up the foul. That's his third.
Glidden's attitude, if you're going to foul him, make sure he doesn't get the shot off. And he didn't.
We've got a 20-second timeout called by IPSW here. 13:29 to go.
Hasn't really been a game that, you know, the Dons early on kind of took control of it. And since then, about the time that one team's had a little bit of momentum going, they've either self-destructed with a couple turnovers or missed a couple shots or had some poor defensive series where it's allowed their opponent to get back into it. We saw the Dons with a surge early and then, you know, probably right calls, but a couple tough call and one no call. That's a make a 5-point swing. Although we've still got a lot of time to go, you know, about that 10-minute mark, you'd like to see one team or the other kind of make a surge and take control, make the other team kind of catch up. So we'll see what happens here in the next 3 or 4 minutes.
Steve wouldn't be at the line, makes the first one.
You know, the other thing you have to consider, Mike, and I'm not trying to be negative about this, because it's obviously two teams that are playing as hard as they possibly can. This is two teams that don't know how to win right now. And Parkside, very much reflective of the Dons, as the second free throw is missed, and that they're a very young team also, only with one senior dressed tonight. You know, you get to a point in the game where it's crunch time with 3 or 4 minutes to go. You look for a body to take over, or a team's competence to take over, and when both teams are struggling, that'll be a real interesting point. So we want to stay tuned to this one. I'm not going anyplace.
Nice inside pass from Worland to Clinton. Ryan Clinton now has 11 points. Lead back up to 4, 52-48. Oh, Evans with the jam. And IBFW's got to do something to stop Craig Evans.
Well, that was a nice jam, but the Dons could have taken a charge and elected instead to try and block it. Kind of difficult to block a dunk unless you want your wrist broken.
Substitution's late to commit for both teams to the next dead ball. 5.5 to go. Whirling going to try a three. Off the rim, no good. Hardiker with the rebound. Bond going to get called for a foul. He wasn't. Here come the Rangers. Change the tire. Take the lead. McCarty inside pass. Hardiker shot up and good. Hardiker's first points in the second half. And we're tied 52 apiece with 12:10 to go. Bond spin move. Forces one up and he's fouled by Hardiker. So Ryan Bond will go to the line. Shoot two.
See, I really think over the summer Ryan's going to work real hard to where when he catches that ball, he can turn and face up and take that 12 or 15 foot jump shot. He adds that to his arsenal. You know, the word's going to get around in scouting reports. They've got to come out to play him. Then he can use his outstanding quickness to put the ball on the floor and take it to the hole from there. Instead, right now, everybody plays him for driving to the basket.
Got mass substitutions all over the place. Let's take a look who's on the floor for Parkside. Bradley's in, Lucas is in, McCarty's in, Evans is in, and I'm looking for a fifth. There we go, number 24, Thad Jacobs is in. Free throw by Ryan Bond is good.
Don's going with a small lineup with Bonds and Miller, Whirling, Jackson, and Showalter.
Bond makes both free throws. He takes a seat on the bench, replaced by Dane Adams. Ryan checks out with 11 points. So IBFW on top, 54-52. Put on some full court pressure. Now they can get a steal. Miller holds up, but he might go inside. Got to convert on the mistake.
Here we go.
Jackson going to call and play here.
That just wasn't very well organized by Parkside. Their press offense was not very organized. They threw it to a spot, nobody was in that spot.
Linton's three bounces off twice, but Miller comes up with the offensive rebound. Linton gonna try again. Yes, Ryan Linton. 7 points and a half, 14 for the game. And it's 57-52, Dons back on top by 5. Inside pass, McCarty lays it up and in.
He has such a quick release. Boy, he catches the ball and the ball's out of his hands really quickly.
It's his first points in the second half. Showalter double team. Now we got a whistle. Jump off.
Showalter was real lucky they didn't call a foul on him, because right before that jump ball, he lowered his shoulder and kind of banged somebody out of the way.
Telling his other teammates, help him.
We talked about that a couple games ago. It's not just a matter of when you're double teamed, of course somebody's open, but they've got to get in a position to where you can get them to basketball.
Lynn tries to get the ball inside to Adams. Ball knocked away. And a traveling ball going to be called for a turnover apiece. And IPFW looks out and gets the ball back. 10 minutes, 40 seconds left here at the Gates Sports Center. 57-54, our score on PFW on tap. Over Wisconsin Parkside, both teams looking for win number 7 on the year. Lynn loses the ball, and he's fouled by Lucas. So Calvin Lucas picks up his first foul. Team 4.
Dons may say, can we take the ball out of bounds at the opposite end? We're doing much better in transition up and down the floor. This half-court stuff we're having problems with.
Cal Kirby back in the lineup, replacing Showalter for IPFW. Litton kicks it out. Kirby. 20 on the shot clock. IPFW looking for the best shot possible. And Miller throws it away.
That's a tough pass. That is a really tough pass. And you've got a cross-court lob between one small guy to another small guy. And you're going across seven bodies that are 6'6", 6'7", 6'8".
Got Sonny Rogers back in the lineup for Parkside, replacing Levi Bradley. Nope, Bradley's in there.
Great one. Great one. Guy over here.
Replacing McCarty.
You know, I'm going to be real surprised if the Dons don't stay with this pressure, or at least, you know, Andy's kind of used it as a surprise factor so far. Maybe not surprise them with it a little bit more often, because the Rangers have not shown an ability to stay organized against it, and when they have broken it, it's been a one-on-one move.
Pass from Kirby to Glenn. Ryan couldn't handle it. Ball goes off his fingertips out of bounds. Lidke back in the lineup for Lucas for Parkside, and Jason Worley going to check back in the lineup for IPFW. He replaces Ryan Glitch. Glitch checks out. He scores 7 points here in the second half to go along with the 70 he had in the first half. Evans inside pass intended.
Nice job Jacob by Jackson. Ray fought over the pick well and tapped the ball away.
Rangers put it underneath their own basket. 9:55 to go. They trail by 3, 57-54. Evans on the high post. 12 on the shot clock. Bumping going on between Bradley and Kirby. No call yet. Now inside pass. Bradley knocked away by Kirby. Nice play. Jackson getting control of the basketball. Inside pass, Adams. Turnaround shot, partially blocked by Evans.
Well, JJ had him about a step earlier and didn't see him. If he could have got it there, Adams would have had an unobstructed basket.
Evans thought about a three. Passed it off his head.
Kirby really working on Levi Bradley, their leading scorer. But he's got to be careful. He's got three fouls.
I think he stepped on the end line. So good defense by Kirby, forcing the turnover.
Good shot.
Dons with the basketball as we approach the 9-minute mark. They're up by 3 here at the Gates Sports Center. Hope you're enjoying the action here on Channel 6. Give it go, ball knocked away. Oh, Adams forgot it, put it up and in.
Oh, great body control. Caught the ball, was behind the backboard. Had to expose it, clear across his left shoulder in order to put it in on the right side.
First points of the night for Dane Adams, and the lead goes up to 5. Watch out. There might be a 5-second count there. I'm not sure what's counting. The seconds. Rogers just inside the arc hits. Sonny Rogers has his first points in the second half. He has 5 overall. Lead down to 3. Whirling for 3. Yes, Jason Whirling.
Boy, the key to that play was Jackson's penetration. Jack penetrated, and all 5 Parkside players stood around to watch. Whirling just loaded it up.
Now they're going to traveling call. Hold on, Sonny Rogers.
Here's that period in the game where they can take control. They've got a 6-point lead with the basketball. If they can score here, they can really take control of stuff. And we're we're going to have a timeout on Parkside.
Timeout on the floor. 6256 dots on top. We'll be back in just a moment.
And he was hit by a truck and killed. And then at the hospital, it was very hard to make a decision to donate organs because we had never discussed it before. I didn't donate. I didn't have a chance to help someone else better their life. I regret it now.
Welcome back to the Gate Sports Center, everybody. Mike Mosh, Jerry Garrado with you. And Jerry, IPFW's been able to maintain this lead throughout most of the second half.
Well, you know, they played back and forth with it. They had a 2 or 3 point lead, and they had a 6 point lead, and it got cut back down to 2 or 3. But it's not just the lead, it's been the momentum. And right now, Wisconsin Parkside is not playing with any offensive organization. Defensively, they're getting beat down the floor. And the thing that I really like is we see the Dons playing with a great deal of enthusiasm. You know, right now, mentally, they feel that they can win the game right now. And Parkside's got to be going, oh, God, here we go again. And, you know, that is absolutely critical. If the Dons can maybe get like a little 6-2 run right now, they may be able to put Parkside away.
Well, we got a whistle and a push-off foul, I believe, on Steve Lickie on Parkside. And it's his second team fifth.
You know, and even though we talked about the Dons had to kind of shore things up interior and baseline-wise defensively, they've also done a nice job of shutting down McCarty and Bradley, who averaged 34 points between the two of them.
Nice turnaround jumper by Jets. Jets has 5 points now. And the lead's up to 8, 64-56.
Big possession for the Rangers here. Big possession.
Been the hot hand for him. Triple team. Oh, he got hit. No call. Lipke for three. Oh, big bucket by Steve Lipke. He now has 9 points.
I guess Parkside decided they don't want to roll over. Good. We'll see also if that timeout, if the Dons decide on dead ball possessions or free throws to go ahead and throw that press at Parkside. They had a great deal of success with that.
We're under 7 minutes now. 54-59 to score. IPFW on top. Shot clock about to go off, and Lindsay comes up with the ball, so turnover IPFW. Not a good offensive possession for IPFW. Lipke calls play number three. Let's see what it is.
Looks like they want to isolate McCarty one-on-one inside against Adam. Oh, that was a poor call because his feet never left the floor. It was a great fake. I mean, it faked us out. I thought he was pulling up for a shot, but he went up on his tiptoes and his foot never moved.
IPFW timeout. Comes with 6:18 to go.
The College Cable Access Program Guide provides information about our programming, including IPFW Sports Telecast. To receive your free Channel 6 Program Guide, send your name, address, and zip code to Channel 6 at IPFW, 2101 Coliseum Boulevard East, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46805, or call us at 481-6000.
Thinking about having a career in television? I asked if you ever thought about having a career in television.
Yeah. Didn't he just call for us to read item two?
No, Jerry, yeah. We've got 6 minutes, 18 seconds left. Take a look at the team foul situation. Both teams with 5 team fouls in the second half. So each team has one to give. Would you start expecting some full court pressure on the part of Parkside at this point?
You know, I have not seen any organized defensive things from them except a half court man. They haven't run any matchup. They haven't run any zone at all. And it would be real difficult for them to run any kind of pressure defense against IPFW with the lineup they have in right now. You know, with Jackson and Miller and Horling, you've got three guys that handle the ball awful well. And as soon as the Dickens, as we see that, now they come out in a 1-2-2 half-court zone. Now the Dons have got to make the adjustment. Their guards have got to recognize, and they've got to get the open shots.
Horling's three is off the rim. Bradley gets down with the rebound. Rangers come down quickly. Adams trying to front Evans. Rogers takes it in. Oh, he took a step, didn't get caught, hits the deck. Makes the layup.
Ouch. That was, he went down on his elbow and on his knee, and that's gotta hurt. You know, I have really been dazzled that Parkside has not run something special in order to try to get the ball to Bradley and to McCarty. If nothing else, you know, take the ball away from him, swing it back around, let McCarty go outside, Bradley go inside, and run a little two-man game. You know, where if you sag inside on Bradley, McCarty's got that great ability to pop threes, and we haven't seen anything special run for them at all. And, you know, McCarty only has had maybe six or seven touches since he had those two threes early.
Well, right now, the lead is only three inside. Pet Kirby loses the ball out of bounds. Whoa, Kirby and McCarty almost went at it.
Two hard-nosed kids that don't back down from anybody. But see, right now we are not seeing the Dons these last two possessions. Even though Whirling got a good baseline shot, they haven't had good movement, haven't adjusted well to that zone. Good move by Parkside's coaching staff.
There's Rogers with the basketball, and they kick it back up top. Trying to get Rogers open on a double screen. Kicks it. Now they got a whistle. Double dribble. Levi Bradley has a quizzical look on his face. Big turnover for Parkside. Bond back in the lineup for the Dons.
Yeah, I had that look like I haven't had double dribble called on me since about the fourth grade.
Now we got Casey Runyon trying to get back in the lineup too. So we've got Bond, Runyon, Jackson, Whirling and Kirby on the floor for IPFW.
Well, the wheels turn. You know, Andy's in a position where, okay, they're not going to press us. All right, now we've got to have some people that shoot the ball a little bit better from the outside. Runyon a better shooter than Miller is. So you got Jack to run things out front, Whirling and Runyon on the wings in order to be able to pop some threes.
Jackson takes it all the way, misses the shot. McCarty with the rebound, Jackson with the foul.
Silly foul. Silly foul. You know, Jackson knew, I think, that Jeff's shot was not the most advised. He was off balance, didn't have a real good angle on the backboard. And when it got rebounded, it was just kind of, you know, I'm so doggone mad at myself, I'm going to do something real silly. And probably 5 seconds after he did, it was, oh, man, what am I thinking? And this is where the Dons have had problems, obviously. Close ball games, when they've had the opportunity to put a team away, they've had it and let it slip away. Now, we'll see if Parkside's got the gumption enough to take it away from them.
That was the seventh team foul. We made a mistake, and we corrected. Seventh team foul on IPFW, so that sent McCarty to the line. He knocks the first one and the second one down.
You know, not the guy you want to foul, obviously. This kid leads the conference in free throw shooting and is one of the top 10 in the country, D2, in free throw shooting.
He makes the lead just a single point, 64-63. Just under 4.5 minutes to go here.
Dons have had three series against the zone, have not scored, and have only caught the rim once.
Jackson hits a big three. Big three by Jackson. He now has 8 points. That couldn't have come at a better time for IPFW.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, realistically, Andy's probably saying no, 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 because Jackson's only about a 25% three-point shooter, and he looked like about a 60% three-point shooter on that puppy.
The lead is four. We're under 4 minutes.
Don's playing nice, help defense.
Parkside trying to work the ball in.
What a great defensive series. They are really working at it.
Runyon knocks it away. Big turnover there. 3-on-3. Whirling didn't see it, nearly lost it. Hits run. Oh, Bond underneath. Bond lays it up. Yes!
What a big bucket. Oh, did these guys need this last 40 seconds? They played tremendous defense. They're rewarded by a turnover. They hustle the ball down the floor, and Bond says, finally, I get the ball inside, and I only have to play against one player.
and foul is on Rogers. And if he has us, let's plot some strategy. So they call a timeout. 3:28 to go. We'll be back in just a moment.
Picasso painted The Old Guitarist during a period of depression that lasted 4 years. His blue period. Today, with new discoveries, 80% of depressive disorders are being successfully treated, giving hope to millions that maybe now nobody has to have a blue period.
Center. 3 minutes, 28 seconds left. IPFW with a 6-point lead, 69-63, and a chance to add one more to it as Ryan Bond will be at the foul line, shooting one free throw. Ryan, so far tonight, has put up 9 free throw attempts, and he's made 7 of them. He's also made 3 field goals for 13 points.
You know, Mike, what I'm so excited about are twofold. That's the first time in a month I've seen a smile on Ryan Bond's face on the floor. And he's such a great kid. You really cheer for him to get going. Second thing is that the fans here really were into the game early when it was a racehorse game. But that last series, both defensively and offensively, with Bond scoring, getting fouled, boy, the crowd just really got into it.
Free throw is no good. McCarty comes down with the rebound. So the lead stays at 6, and in essence, it's a 2-possession ball game right now.
I gotta believe you've gotta run something for Bradley and McCarty. You've just got to. They've been your go-to guys all year.
Working the perimeter, trying to get somebody free underneath.
Boy, the Dons have just cranked up their defense about a notch and a half here over the last
4
minutes.
Oh, inside pass. Hardiker puts it up, puts it in.
Nice little swipe move as he pushed Bond out of the way.
69-65. Bond says it's having back. Cut off. Inside. Nice feed to Kirby. Kirby's fouled. And Kyle,
see, that was
line,
a real bright
two.
Move on Ryan's spot. I firmly believe if he hadn't made that play the series before where he got fouled, he probably would have forced that shot up because he was a little frustrated in that. You know, he'd gotten taken out of the play. Putin had kind of bumped him out of the way, and, you know, he kind of got isolated and got beat. He comes back down, he goes one-on-one, and he gets shut off. And rather than force it up, he gives a little head fake, nice drop-off pass to Kirby, cutting down the middle. Real smart move by Ryan.
They call that foul on Hardiker, and they say that that is his 5th, not his 4th, so Mark fouls out, scoring 9 points tonight. And Kirby comes back and knocks down the first free throw. He's only scored 3 points in the second half, but he's hit 6 shots in a row from the floor after missing his first 2, so he's 75% action from the floor tonight. Second free throw is good.
You know, he got himself in some foul trouble, and it really kind of took him out of the rhythm of the game early in the second half.
71-65, IPFW with the lead, 2.5 minutes to go.
Casey Runyon has really done a bang-up job on McCarty defensively.
Rogers baseline drive, shot blocked by Kirby, it'll go foul on Kirby. I don't know about that one, Jerry, it looked nice from here.
Well, initially, you know, he went up, got no body on it, blocked the shot, but the follow-through, and this is something that's so difficult to teach a guy to do, is that you go up and you don't block it with a swat of your arm. You keep your arm straight up and you block it with a flip of your wrist. That's what knocks the ball away. It was the follow through with his arm that came down across the shoulder is what caused him to pick up his 4th foul. Or he could have stayed on his feet and picked up a charge, but that's not quite as dramatic as getting a blocked shot.
Rogers knocks down the first one. He now has 8 points tonight, 5 of those coming here in the second half. Second one is good as well, so the lead is now down to 4. Belated whistle, there was a player, Calvin Lucas, was waiting to come in. So he comes in replacing Steve Littke for the Rangers. 2:15 to go now, the lead is only 4, 71-67, nail-biting time.
Parkside back to man-to-man. They've gotten out of that zone.
Boy, good effort by McCarty. He nearly pulled off the steal, but stepped on the sideline.
He's going to make our all-hustle team for the year. He is just really a scrappy, hard-nosed player. I really like him. Plus, he shoots a Dickens out of it.
2 minutes to go. Parkside steps up their defensive pressure now. 10 on the shot clock. Whirling inside. Runyon forces it up. No good. Rebound fought for. Out of bounds. They say IPFW basketball.
Well, that's a lucky bounce because now you got a fresh 35.
And another timeout being called. I believe Parkside's calling this one.
I think the Dons called that one.
You too can join in the excitement of IPFW Athletics by participating in the Royal Dons Club. Royal Dons Club is the official booster club for IPFW's athletic teams. Members enjoy priority seating at all IPFW sports events, food and refreshments in the hospitality room, admission to IPFW sports media luncheons, and association with other Mastodon supporters, just to name a few benefits. For information on becoming a member of the Royal Dons Club, call Pat Klein at 481-6643 or write to the Royal Dons Club, 2101 Coliseum Boulevard East, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46805. Well, Jerry, 1:45 left. The lead's only 4. What's going on at both benches right now? What are the coaches saying?
Well, Parkside's saying we got to keep up the defensive pressure. We've got to make sure we get good shots. We've got so much time left. You've got at least 3 possessions to go on things, so don't throw up something crazy. Don't give them anything unmolested, and if you're going to foul somebody, foul, and then he's going through their roster. You know, something obviously about scouted ahead of time about who you can foul and who you can't. Andy really wants a bucket on this possession because now you're looking at a 6-point or possibly even a 7-point lead. The other thing is when they've taken the ball out of bounds under their own basket, the Dons have not had very much success at getting into their offense here in the second half.
Oh, turnover. Jackson forced out by Lucas. If you're a Parkside fan, you like that play. And if you're an IPFW fan, you're saying, wait a minute, that's
that looked
been
like
a foul.
An old NBA force out.
Let's see what develops. Evans watched by Kirby. Inside pass. Shot up. Good. Counted. And a foul. Worst case scenario for IPFW. Fouls on Ryan Bond, his first. But McCarty makes the bucket, gets a free throw, and he can bring him within 1.
You know, hopefully we can jinx him, but you put him at the free throw line, you might as well just put the points up and start trotting back to the other end.
Free throw's good. It's 18 points now for Ryan McCarty in a 1-point game with 1:25 to go. Hang on to your seats, folks. We've got a good one here at the Gate Sports Center.
And now Poise takes over. Which team's got the most amount of it? Jack's about to get called on 5.
17 in the shot clock. 1:05 on the game clock.
Lucas really dogging Jackson defensively.
Whirling for 3. No. McCarty with the rebound. Under a minute to go.
Bond made a great defensive play. Gave
Bond
a fake salt like he was running away and stepped back in and got the steal. What a sensational defensive play.
And he calls timeout with 49 seconds left to set up some strategy. Now, Jerry, you're Andy Piazza. You got the ball, 1-point lead, 49 seconds left, 32 on the shot clock. Now what do you do?
Now, see, there's where the big difference is between high school and college basketball, is you've got 32 seconds left. So you know that they are at least going to get one more shot. You need another score. In addition to the score, then you've got to consider, all right, who are their best 3-point shooters? All right, to this point, McCarty's hit a couple early. I think Lucas had 1. Otherwise, they haven't hurt you a whole lot from 3-point range. But when we get down to the other end, boys, you've got to make sure that you're playing McCarty, and for gosh sakes, don't foul him from 3-point. You know, what could be the worst case scenario is let him drain a 3 and foul him, and then let it turn into a 4-point play. The other thing Andy may be doing is say, look, we haven't run it for a while. Let's take a look at some full court pressure and see if we can get them to turn it over. Because if we can get a bucket here or at least run the clock down to 16, 18 seconds and get a turnover, now we put ourselves in a position where they have to foul us.
Now let's see what happens. We've got Kirby, Worley, Jackson, Bond, Runyon on the floor for IPFW. Lucas, Rogers, McCarty, Bradley, and Evans on the floor for Parkside. Runyon to inbound it. Jackson's got it. Let's see what happens.
And if I'm Parkside, if Runyon gets the ball, I'm going to foul him. He's shooting under 50% from the free throw line. I'm going to make him beat us from the free throw line.
Instead, good play by Jackson forces Lucas to foul him. So Jeff Jackson goes to the line. He's a 75% free throw shooter. Second foul on Calvin Lucas. It's an 8th foul, so it's a 1-1 situation for Jackson. And I'm not going to say a word, Jerry.
No need to. These are down. See, now the basket expands where it seemed like it was about 2 inches around when you're on the front end. Once you hit the first one, now it's like throwing it into a bushel basket.
Still a big free throw. If he makes this one, it's a 3-point lead. Yes. Two big free throws by Jackson with 37 seconds to go. 73-70.
Look for McCarty off some kind of screen. There's
there
the screen.
Is.
There's McCarty. Great defensive job.
Rogers takes it, misses, ball goes out of bounds.
The Duns do a good job defensively. They ran exactly what we thought they'd run, and Parkside's going to take a timeout.
24 seconds left, 23 in the shot clock, so in essence, shot clock is not a factor. Parkside's got the ball. Woo.
You know, they ran that screen away. McCarty comes off the top of it, and, you know, you ask us what Andy was obviously saying. Obviously said, we're going to step out and stop him. We'll talk more about it. We'll be right back.
Vince, come on, we're late.
This headbang is more fun than going through a windshield.
Good night from Iron Maiden. Drive home safe. Remember to strap yourselves in with your safety belts. You don't want to end up like Eddie.
Belt up. Don't be a dummy.
Welcome back. Final 24 seconds of regulation. IPFW on top, 73-70 over Wisconsin Parkside. Jerry, this is our last broadcast of the season, and I think we saved the best for last. At least the best competitive game IPFW has been in some time.
Oh, absolutely. And if they can win this, it can be such a great thing to take away. You know, you got a lot of folks here. It's been a nice crowd. They've been responsive. It sends them away on a nice note about, you know, next year we've got to come see some more of these Don games. And hopefully some of those people at home will start coming to games. Mike, I've been amazed at how many people watch these games because I've had so many people say something to me over the last couple weeks. Probably into McCarty, a screen away, and they'll bring the ball back to him. Here he comes around the
walking,
screen.
Walking, traveling call!
And the Duns have done it with defense.
But it's not over yet. 19 seconds left. Now you'll see that full court pressure. And
Parkside's going to take a
timeout. Oh, big play there. Bradley went in the lane, took one step too many. It's a 20-second timeout for Parkside. 20-second timeout.
Well, in both plays, Ryan Bond made crucial defensive decisions. The series before, he stepped out and stuck a hand and leaped at McCarty, forced him to have to give up the basketball. And on that drive by Bradley, he did a sensational job of stepping in, helping on the double team, and helping to force the turnover. And again, I go back to a play 4 or 5 minutes ago, seemed like it was a small play, where Bond got that long pass under the basket, made the bucket, and got fouled. I think it did wonders for his confidence.
Kirby is fouled by Evans on the throw-in, so Kyle Kirby, with 1 second going off the clock, will go down. It's only a 1-1, as that's only the 9th team foul. It's his third personal, I'm sorry.
I'm real surprised that one Parkside didn't set up a situation to where Casey Runyon would be able to be allowed to catch the basketball so they could foul him. He's only shooting 45%. And Kirby's first one's good.
Big free throw for Kyle Kirby.
The other thing I was really surprised at was that Andy left him in the game only shooting 45%. Got a four-point difference, but a lot of time. 18 seconds, a lot of time.
Five-point game now. 18 points for Kirby. Three-point shot, no good. Rogers with the rebound. He's going to force one up. In and out, no good. Rebound fought for, controlled by Bond. He's pushed out.
And see, that's inexperience of a team that doesn't know how to win. When you're down five, you don't need a three. You can afford to score two. And the way IPFW is playing defense, they're really spread out on the perimeter. They could have driven to the basket, gotten a quick bucket, and still had like 12 seconds left on the clock and only been down three. Instead, they force up two threes.
Ryan Bond at the line shooting two.
And if these two go down, then I think you will basically see IPFW just stay out of the way.
First one is good. It's 14 points for Ryan. Makes it 76-70. Glidden in the lineup, replacing Runyon. The senior goes out.
Nice move by Andy. That is a classy move.
8 points in his final game here at the Gates Sports Center.
Always like to see that, where you get the senior a chance to come off the floor late in the game so the crowd can acknowledge his presence.
Litke back in the lineup for Rogers for Parkside.
And I'm sure to Casey it makes a big difference that he's coming off in a winning performance.
Second free throw is good, 15 points for Bond. 77-70, 6-5-4, long shot by Lucas, no. McCarty puts it back up and in at the buzzer. It's all over, IPFW 77, Wisconsin Parkside 72.
And Andy Piazza does not have to feel like Atlas carrying the weight of the world on his shoulders anymore.
Let's check the scoring real quick for IPFW. 18 points for Kyle Kirby, 15 for Ryan Bond, 14 for Ryan Glidden, 10 for Jeff Jackson, 8 for KC Runyon, 6 for Jason Werling, 2 apiece for Derek Miller, RJ Falcone, and Dane Adams. For Wisconsin Parkside, they were led by Ryan McCarty with 20 points, 13 for Craig Evans, 10 for Levi Bradley, 9 apiece for Steve Litke and Mark Houdeker and Sonny Rogers, and 2 points for Thad Jacobs. Again, an exciting ball game, 77-72 the final. IPFW in their final home game of the year. Win for the seventh time against 18 losses. Wisconsin Parkside drops to 6-18, and perhaps a glimmer of hope for the future for IPFW, Jerry.
Oh, I think there's a lot of... You know, I think there's an awful lot of future for both these teams. You know, we talked about both their youth, and, you know, the Dons have made runs. We saw a great comeback from 22-point deficit a couple weeks ago to just kind of fall short, you know, as they scrap back in the game to get within three or four, and then they let up a little bit. You could just see how much it meant to the players. I mean, you know, Jackson's out there jumping around like it's a tournament final. These guys deserve a game like that, and they have a great deal to be proud of.
Jerry, I've enjoyed it these last few weeks with you. I hope we can do it again next year.
Oh, I hope so too, Mike.
At this time, we'd like to take this time to thank the Channel 6 volunteer crew and the Learning Resource Center at IPFW for their contributions to the live production of our basketball games this evening. The telecast of this IPFW sports event is copyrighted and the sole property of the College Cable Access Center and IPFW. Unauthorized duplication, exhibition, retransmission, rebroadcast, or other use of this event without express written consent is strictly prohibited. Again, it's been a great night here, senior night for IPFW. It's our last regular season telecast. The girls game, women's game, the Dons came out on top 90-51.
And in this game, best of luck to them in the tournament, not only in these last two games, but, you know, for the girls to be able to go on and maybe pick up a nice little run throughout the D2 tournament. You know, they're playing awfully well right now. Hope those injuries tonight weren't too bad. Yep. Mike, in addition to you putting up with me, I'd also like to thank all the crew and the camera guys for just doing such a super job the last three ball games I've been able to work. And my thanks to Matt DeLong and Kent Orman for extending the opportunity.
Well, I think we've all enjoyed it. Tonight was a nice topper to finish the season off. Again, final scores tonight, women's game, IPFW 90, Wisconsin Parkside 51, and in the men's game, it was IPFW 77, Wisconsin Parkside 72. For Jerry Garrado, and also for Dave Scout, help me in the women's game, I'm Mike Maas, saying thank you very much for tuning in tonight to Channel 6, and good night from the Hilliard Gate Sports Center on the campus of IPFW.